I did.
Good morning, church.
Morning.
God, get a little energy in here. My name is Daniel Longmore. I'm the student ministries pastor around here, if you don't know me. This year has been so screwed up, so crazy. One of the things that we were unable to do at the, you know, normally scheduled time was our graduation Sunday in May, where we recognize the seniors that are graduating. We have them come up. You get to see who they are, where they come from, what they're going to do next. And it was a real shame, because then by the time we were able to start meeting again, some of them had already gone on to boot camp, to college, and so we weren't able to really do it justice by having all of them up here for you to recognize. And so I would encourage you, if you would like to get to know them, the ones that were a part of Free Life, our Wednesday night ministries, we have information on them on our website at gifree.org. You go to the student ministries page and you'll see a list of them, and you can get to know them and where they're going next. Do we have, Sarah, I think you might be the only one. Do we have any seniors in here? Could I get you to stand if you're in here, graduating seniors? That's what I figured. Sarah's up there. She's been helping out with sound. Yeah, big waves. Yeah, give her a round of applause. You guys know how hard it is and the big accomplishment. But we as a staff kind of scrambled, because we said we want to honor all the graduating seniors, even the ones that have already gone. And so we didn't know exactly how to do that. Should we have the few that are left here come up on stage and be honored? We didn't know. So instead, I'm going to pray for them, and I ask that you would get on the website, check them out, see who they are. Because to all of us adults in here, or wannabe adults, we know how hard this world is once you get out of high school, once you leave the nest, once you stretch your wings. Between college, we know they'll have their faith incredibly stretched to the point of breaking on many occasions. Or maybe they're just going into the workforce, where, again, we know the temptations are extreme. The situations that they're going to be put in are going to be extremely difficult. And so to all of us, we need to link prayer arms together and continue praying for them, because their journey is going to get really hard starting now. So I'm going to pray, and I ask that you would go and check them out on the website, but we want to lift them up in prayer at this time. So bow your heads with me. Father God, we lift up these seniors to you. They've gone so far, and us as a church, we've been able to see the seed get planted in so many of them, see so many of them come to Christ, give their life to you. And God, it's about to get very difficult for many of them in many different ways. We know the numbers, we know the stats of students that leave high school and leave you at the door behind them. God, I pray that that would not be the case for these students. I pray that that would not be the case for Grady, Ethan, Charlie, Sarah, Kendra, Olivia, Hannah, Lauren. I pray that that would not be the case for these students, oh God. And I also know many people do lift up students, and those same students still walk away. God, I beg you in this time, do not let that be the case. But instead, during their summer breaks, during their Sunday mornings when they get to be with us, would we be encouraged as a body? Would we be encouraged as we hear what glorious things you're doing in their lives, how they're able to see you through the barriers, through the temptations? When they make mistakes, would they repent and come running back to you? But God, would you lead them as you have led your people for all time? Would you be clear as it gets and allow them to see you? God, so many other students that we know, we need your help, God. They need your help. And would we as a church be reminded of them when we go to you in prayer? Let that be true of us, and let that be true of them, oh God. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Daniel's expecting a number three child here pretty soon. My wife's expecting just number two a little sooner. It seems we're in an arms race with one another. Unfortunately, you have a leg up on me right now. Really? Dad joke? Come on. Dad jokes. Anyway, would you please stand with us? We're going to begin with a reading of Psalm 89. Ms. Jeanette will begin the reading. I will invite you to join along shortly.
I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever, and with my mouth I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. For I said, steadfast love will be built up forever, and in the heavens you will establish your faithfulness. Let the heavens praise your wonders, O Lord, your faithfulness in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies could be compared to the Lord? Who among the heavenly beings is like the Lord, a God greatly to be feared in the council of the holy ones, and awesome above all who are around him?
Now please, read this with us. O Lord God of hosts, who is mighty as you are, O Lord, with your faithfulness all around you? The heavens are yours, the earth also is yours. The world and all that is in it, you have founded them. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Steadfast love and faithfulness go before.
See you. my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe is made.
Father, we thank you for the opportunity as one people gathered to declare the truth, how great you are, Lord. So help us each day and each hour. May we become less, that you may become more in our lives. We declare you, Lord, sovereign over all, and that includes my life. Father, help us keep our eyes on you. Show us your glory, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. So you guys decided to come indoors and bypass the 81% humidity? We thought we would have second hour instead of doing it now. We thought what we would do is we would go outside today at 4 during the heat of the day. Separate the wheat from the chaff, so to speak, right? No. Well, it is wonderful to have you here. I want to, last week I used an illustration about a former boyfriend of my wife's, for those of you who were here. You heard that. I used an illustration as, you know, that, man, my wife could have married a lot of other guys besides me. And so with that, against that backdrop, there was a family attending church. I don't want to recognize them because I don't want to embarrass them, of course, but there was a family, and after church, they were doing their thing, and the dad says, "Hey, what'd you guys learn?" Which one of the family members said that, "Well, I learned that Julie could have married up big time." Yep, pretty much the big idea of the entire message. Thank you very much. We've given that family a map to a different church. No, I'm kidding. This morning, Julie was having her quiet time. I was getting ready to head out the door to come here, and she reminded me of a passage, and I thought, this doesn't have anything to do with my message, but I think it has everything to do with my message, and it's just a great reminder to all of us. It comes out of Paul writing to the church at Corinth. Just a couple of verses here I want to read. It says, Paul's talking to the church at Corinth, and he says, "My message and my preaching were not in persuasive words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power, that your faith should not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God." And it was just a great reminder that, you know what? God is the one who's responsible to grow you up. I work hard on these messages, but if it's just my messages, well, you might gain some knowledge. But if you're to grow in your relationship with Jesus Christ, it's because the Spirit of God turns on the light bulb and you are impassioned in your love for Him, because God takes your heart and molds it into His image. And apart from God doing a miraculous work in your life, well, sermons are just kind of a exercise in futility. But if we surrender to God and we say, "God, have your way with us," not because of the messages that are prepared, but in spite of the messages that are prepared. And that's why we come together, to submit to God and allow Him to say, "Hey, God, would you replace in me wrong thinking and supplant it with biblical truth?" So let me pray for us. Lord, this morning, as we continue to look into the book of Ruth, Lord, we're reminded that your word is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of joint and marrow, discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. This is supernatural business we're talking about. This isn't about us kind of trying to grow one another up. The harder we try, and this is about submitting to you and saying, "God, have your way with us." Spirit of the living God, would you fall afresh on us? Would you do in us a work that we cannot do ourselves? Transform us from the inside out. We ask you that in Jesus' matchless holy name. I hope in our journey through the book of Ruth, you've picked up that all of the Old Testament, specifically the book of Ruth, set the stage and prepare the world for Jesus' first advent. That's a fancy word for his arrival, where we celebrated his birth. The story of the Bible is a story of redemption. You could turn to, you know, any number of dictionaries and you could get a definition of redemption. The definition that I've always kind of taken on, maybe created a little bit, maybe a little bit of liberty with, but I think the definition of redemption is that God brings things back to the way they were intended to be. When you consider God's story, he creates, everything's in perfect harmony. There's a fall. Sin is infused, and all of creation becomes corrupt. Then the story of the Bible is God, through his Son, destroys sin and recreates the world into a sin-free state that we refer to as a new heaven and a new earth. That's the story of the Scriptures. And the story of Ruth is a microcosm of that narrative. A man and a wife have two sons, then they're victimized by sin and death. Leaves two widows. And God intervenes through a faithful man named Boaz to redeem these two widows and reinstate them to a preserved, debt-free environment. We could look at it another way. We examine now how Jesus, God's Son, redeems creation. And you don't want to miss the fact that God obeyed his own law when he accomplished our salvation in and through Jesus. What do I mean by that? Well, we could take a number of passages. Go back to a random one. Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 4. It says this, "The soul who sins shall die." Well, God didn't sidestep that proclamation. That's why God did not spare his own son, but delivered Jesus up for us all. There was no one else that qualified who was capable of redeeming a lost world. And Acts chapter 4, verse 12 confirms, "There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we can be saved." Therefore, Jesus died the death we deserve, and as a result, the penalty is paid. Man is made new. And the book of Ruth captures that storyline. Ruth owes a debt she can never repay on her own. One man, though, can qualify to pay the debt. And Boaz volunteers to pay that debt, and Ruth is redeemed. Last week, we looked at chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. Naomi, the mother-in-law of Ruth, she sets a plan to get Boaz to redeem her daughter. Well, Boaz was a relative of Naomi's deceased husband. By law, he could marry Ruth, pay off her family debt, and enable Ruth's husband's good name to live on. But there's a problem. As much as Boaz would like to marry Ruth, by law, there is a nearer relative that has first dibs on redeeming Ruth and Naomi. See, Boaz couldn't overlook this reality, and therefore he had to be honest. He couldn't hide it from Ruth. Boaz was committed to Ruth's well-being. He wanted to be with her, but he also didn't want to manipulate the story, even if it meant he couldn't be with her. It was late at night when we left the story last week. Boaz promises Ruth he will attend to the situation first thing in the morning. Until morning, he instructs Ruth to sleep under his protection. That night was a long night. Wondering, dreaming, Boaz is thinking, will I be the one to redeem Ruth's story, or will the next of kin agree to redeem Ruth's story? Because I want to marry this woman of my dreams. A lot's going to ride on the meeting that he will have the next morning, and Boaz knows all too well. Boaz was willing to count the cost to redeem Ruth, pay off her debt, but he was not going to disobey God and take matters into his own hands. So we pick up the story in chapter 3, verses 14 through 17. I'm reading from the New American Standard Translation. Let me read it to you. It says, "So she lay at his feet until morning." She there is Ruth, lay at Boaz's feet until morning. "Arose before one could recognize another. And he said, let it not be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. Again, he said, give me the cloak that is on you and hold it. So she takes off this covering around her head. She turns it basically into a grocery sack. So she held it, and then Boaz measured 6 measures of barley, laid it on her. Then she went into the city. When she came to her mother-in-law, she said, how did it go, my daughter? Naomi's asking Ruth, how did it go, my daughter? And she told her all that the man had done for her. And so Naomi said, these 6 measures of barley he gave to me, for he said, do not go to your mother-in-law empty-handed. Pretty good strategic move for a future potential son-in-law. Ruth in the past had been treated well by Boaz. His workers allowed her to glean the best that the field could yield. Boaz saw to it that Ruth was protected. Boaz had shared that all that he has is hers, even serving her lunch. He had previously enabled Ruth to bring home 5 days' worth of food, 3 meals a day for 2 people. Now Boaz fills her cloak with 2 bushels of grain, which is more than 2 weeks' supply of grain for 2 people. And Boaz gives Ruth every reason to believe that she has no grounds to be afraid. He is going to provide for her. There's no validity in her fear because he's going to see to it that her needs are taken care of. Then in verse 16, Naomi asks the question. Now, I believe the New American Standard, the translation, it takes a little bit of liberty, because in the New American Standard, it says, Naomi says, well, how did it go, my daughter? Which is a fair interpretation. But in actuality, the Hebrew text says, who are you, my daughter? Now, by asking the question, who are you, my daughter, Naomi is saying, are you still Ruth, the Moabite woman, or are you now the future Mrs. Boaz? Naomi's asking, will you remain in your impoverished state? Or is God through Boaz giving us a new lease on life, a new beginning with its hope, assurance, and provision? Appropriate question to ask for our own self-examination. We could ask it every morning, who are you? Personalizing that, I could answer the question, well, am I Dan? Am I still Dan, the lost, selfish, finite, insecure, unforgiven, groping around in the dark for significance person? Or am I Dan, redeemed by the cross of Christ, hopeful with the promise of new beginnings and a daily do-over to experience fresh starts and new beginnings? What a difference perspective makes, doesn't it? Observation. Do you remember when Naomi returned to Bethlehem? As a widow, she said, I am empty. She also said, don't call me Naomi, call me bitter. She could no longer claim to be empty, and neither can we. You know, we may not know when provision comes, but we can rest under the wings of God and know, just as the psalmist said in Psalm 31:19, how great God is your goodness, which you have stored up for those who fear you. Who are you? Well, Naomi could no longer say, just the empty one, I'm better. No, she's the one who's experienced the grace of God. See, Naomi and Ruth are now living under the grace of God. They're surrendering to God, who is truly the only one that can do for them what they are incapable of doing for themselves. That's what it is, living under grace. We can live as if our future is dependent on our own knowledge, our own abilities, our own giftedness, our own works, or we can live under the grace of God, allowing Him to do for us what we are incapable of doing for ourselves. See, to live under grace, we need to work responsibly, but trust dependently. Work responsibly as if it depends on you. Work is honoring to God. We put our best foot forward. We do that which is honoring to God. We work responsibly, but we trust God dependently as if the outcome is dependent on Him, which it is. So to live under the grace of God, work responsibly, but trust dependently. Now look at verse 18. Then she said, Naomi speaking, wait, my daughter, wait, Ruth, until you know how the matter turns out, for the man will not rest until he has settled it today. There's not a person in this room that enjoys waiting. We hate waiting. Waiting is maddening, isn't it? Whether it's standing in the DMV line. I love that movie where, you know, what's the one where it's like all the DMV workers are sloths? You know, it's like waiting is maddening, isn't it? But that's just circumstantial waiting. What about waiting for some diagnosis that could alter the trajectory of your life? And in Ruth's case, she's waiting to see, well, who is going to redeem me? Is it going to be this next of kin, or will it be Boaz, the man I've grown to love? And Naomi's counsel to Ruth is literally, sit still. Our human nature gets antsy. We don't like to sit still because there's an alternative. We can help God out. And when we do, when we jump in too quick, when we fail to wait, we open ourselves up to self-induced frustration. Let me give you just kind of an example. This is an obvious example. Moses goes to Mount Sinai. He's going to receive what you and I know is the Ten Commandments. The nation just know he's receiving instruction from God. And the nation in the valley, as Moses goes up to Mount Sinai, they get a little bit antsy, and they come up with this harebrained idea of building a golden calf. It's recorded in Exodus chapter 32. And because of not waiting on the Lord, taking matters into their own hands, there's consequences to not waiting. When you take matters into your own hands, and as a result, well, 3,000 people of the nation of Israel, they die. See, when we fail to wait and we take matters into our own hands, it doesn't stop God from accomplishing what He chooses to accomplish. But many times when we fail to wait, well, when we take matters into our own hands, sometimes we get written out of the script. And Ruth waited. Now, the reason she waited is not because she was just commanded to wait. The reason she waited is because she believed that Boaz is going to deliver on what he said he was going to deliver on. And the reason we wait on the Lord is because God is trustworthy and will deliver on what he says he's going to do. See, the evidence of whether we trust God is found sometimes in our willingness to sit still and allow God to do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. That's why the psalmist says in Psalm 46:10, "Be still and know that I am God." When we're still, the way we know that he is God is he does for us what we cannot do for ourselves, and it's confirmation, wow, he is God. Question to ask at this point is, how do I know if I should wait? You know, because there's sometimes we think, well, should I take initiative? Should I wait? How do you know if you should wait? How do you know if you should take initiative? I think the question is, when you're meddling could make things worse, well, that's a sure sign that you should wait. When you know my meddling might make things worse, then you know what? I think that's a pretty good indication. I need to wait on the Lord. Be still. Know that he is God. Now the question becomes, what will happen? How's God going to let this story unfold? Well, let's look at chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. "Now Boaz went up to the gate of the city, sat down there, and behold, the close relative," what a coincidence, of whom Boaz spoke was passing by. Boaz said to them, "Hey, I've got a Coke and a donut here. Turn aside, friend, sit down here." The Coke and the donut, that's in the New American Standard Version. And so this next closest relative turned aside and sat down. In verse 2, he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, "Sit down here." Now you have to understand that the city gate was kind of where the civil court was, where you'd have elders sitting there. And if you had some decision that needed to be made, something that needed to kind of be driven down to say, hey, an agreement's been made, you would go to the city gate and the elders there would gather and you would present your situation before them, and they would be eyewitnesses to make sure this decision was on the up and up. Then in verse 3, "Then he said to the closest relative, Naomi, who has come back from the land of Moab," you remember her, don't you? "Has to sell the piece of land which belonged to her brother, to our brother Elimelech," her husband. Again, I've got to give you some background here. The kinsman redeemer laws are laid out in Leviticus chapter 25. When obeyed, these laws made sure that a dead man's family name did not die with him and that his property was not sold to someone outside of the tribe. In the case of Ruth and Naomi, when Naomi's husband Elimelech died, his property passed to his sons, Chilion and Mahlon. When those sons died, Naomi and Ruth, who was Mahlon's wife, were left holding the debt. Evidently, there was some kind of mortgage that was owed, and Ruth and Naomi couldn't pay it. They didn't have the means to pay it. Don't miss the connection. Because of sin, we have inherited a debt that we are unable to pay, and as a result, we are mortgaged to Satan. Unable to pay the debt on our own, unable to free ourselves. Now, the scriptures were quite clear on who qualified to be a kinsman redeemer. There were 5 qualifications to become a kinsman redeemer. They're all found in Leviticus 25. The first requirement of becoming a kinsman redeemer is a kinsman redeemer had to be a near relative. He had to be related to the person he's trying to redeem. We know that Boaz is related to Naomi. We know that this other relative is related to Naomi. Second, he had to have the means to pay the redemptive price. Well, we know that Boaz had the means to pay the redemptive price. We know that this other man had the means to pay the redemptive price. Third, a kinsman redeemer had to be willing to pay the price. He could have the money, but not the motivation. Well, we know that Boaz is willing. We haven't read ahead at this point. We don't know if this other man is willing to redeem the story or not. Fourth qualification of a kinsman redeemer, he had to have a way of completing the transaction legally. Well, that's exactly why Boaz gathered the elders at the city gate, because this was the place to make that decision legal. There were 10 elders there, which made it more than confirmable. And then fifth, the kinsman redeemer, the redemption is complete only when the price has been paid. He had to be a near relative. Think about Jesus as your kinsman redeemer. He became flesh and dwelt among us. He became a man. He became a relative. He became one of us, which qualified him as our ultimate kinsman redeemer. Second qualification, he had to have the means to pay the redemptive price. We know that Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin on our behalf that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He had to have the means to pay. Jesus was a perfect sacrifice. Third, he had to be willing to pay the price. We know that Jesus, from Philippians chapter 2, emptied himself. Didn't consider heaven a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a bondservant, dying, even dying a death on the cross. He was willing to pay the price. Fourth, he had to have a way of completing the transaction. See, our sin demanded a capital punishment. And for Jesus, that means of accomplishing that payment for death was the cross. And so therefore he paid that capital punishment. And the redemption was complete only when the price had been paid. And that's why when Jesus hung on the cross and he said, "It is finished," he accomplished it. He died. The debt had been paid. Jesus completed his mission. Price was paid. See, I want you to understand something. When you look from a 20,000 foot view of history, God orchestrates all of history to pull off the payment of our death sentence. What's the Bible about? It's about redemption. That God has orchestrated all of history to pull off the payment of our debt. Now, the question becomes, what will be the response of this next of kin? Let's look at it in verse 4. "So I thought to inform you," Boaz is speaking, "by it," meaning this debt, this mortgaged piece of property, "before those who are sitting here, these witnesses, and before the elders of all the people, if you will redeem it, redeem it. But if not, tell me that I may know. For there is no one but you to redeem it, and I am after you." And immediately this next of kin said, "I'll redeem it." And you go, wait a minute. That's not what we're after in the story. I don't want this next of kin to redeem this. That's not what I was hoping for. I wanted Boaz to redeem this story. He's my hero. And now this guy is going to redeem the mortgage? Did we hear that right? God, you're ruining the story. But wait a minute. Because I think what Boaz is doing is he is setting up this next of kin. Boaz is setting the man up because what initially appears to be a beneficial transaction will all of a sudden get a little more complicated. See, if the transaction is just about buying out this piece of property, therefore gaining this land, well, that's an easy, good for me, no-brainer. But look at verse 5. Boaz has put this guy on a tee. And then Boaz said, "Oh, by the way, on the day that you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you must also acquire Ruth. And did I mention to you, she's a Moabitess, the widow of the deceased, in order to raise up the name of the deceased on his inheritance." Now, Boaz purposefully complicates the transaction by rightfully revealing two very important pieces of information here. First of all, he says, hey, you don't get the land without getting the wife. And by the way, the wife, her name is Ruth, and did I tell you, she's a Moabitess. Now, it's hard for us to grasp the weight of that statement without placing it in the context of our own culture. It would be like someone saying, hey, sure, you can buy the land, but you get the wife with the land, and hey, the wife, well, she's a member of the Taliban. Or did I tell you, yeah, Ruth, she's with ISIS. Whoa, and all of a sudden, all the racial tension comes out in this next of kin's mind because he just begins to fast forward all, what are the neighbors going to say? What if her former family starts coming after her? what's Thanksgiving dinner going to look like? I'm not sure I want that on my plate. And then second, Boaz points out, hey, you know what? If you marry Ruth, by the way, also, this Moabitess, well then, you, sir, might jeopardize your own inheritance. Well, how would he jeopardize his own inheritance? And Boaz points out to this next of kin, if you had a son by Ruth, and that son was your only surviving heir, not only would Ruth's former husband's property go to this son of Ruth, but part of your own estate would have to go to this son of Ruth. In fact, you lose a lot in the deal. And with that information, how did the next of kin respond? Look at verse 6. The closest relative said, hey, thanks for the donut. I can't redeem this. By the way, I hear my mom calling. I've got to go. Thanks so much for the time. Gentlemen, sorry to waste your time. I would jeopardize my own inheritance. I'm out of here. Redeem it yourself. You may have my right of redemption. What do I need to sign? I cannot do it. That was Dan Brenton version there of the New American Standard. The nearest of kin backs out of the deal so fast his head spins. Maybe it's some of the Moabite factor a little bit, but it seems as though a clear motivation was his own inheritance. Because the whole idea in the culture, you wanted your name to continue. You wanted your own name to live on. It seems his motivation was about his own inheritance. He wanted his name to be great. He wanted his name to live on. Now, please observe something. Purposefully, the author of Ruth has never mentioned his name. You don't know his name. And his motivation is that his name would live on. And yet, 3,000 years after the fact, we're not talking about his name, are we? We don't even know his name. And all of history doesn't know his name. But who are we talking about? We're talking about Boaz, who gave up his stake for fame, who lived to make God's name great, and the implications are simple. So are you living to make your name great? Or are you living to make God's name great? See, men in history that lived to make their own name great, you remember them. But you remember them for all the wrong reasons. The Caesars and the Brutuses and the Napoleons and the Edies and the Adolfs. And you remember them, but you remember them for the wrong reasons, and that's why you name your dogs after them. See, the men and women in history that we remember for the right reasons lived to make God's name great. And Boaz's name is written down in Scripture and held in honor along with the Abrahams and the Isaacs and the Josephs and the Moseses and the Joshuas and the Calebs and the Ruths and the Davids and the Solomons and the Esthers and the Daniels and the Ezekiels and the Marys and the Elizabeths. And you go on and on with the apostles. And that's why John writes in 1 John 2:17, he who does the will of God abides forever. Are you living to make God's name great? Or are you living to make your own name great? See, the people who live to make their own name great are quickly forgotten. But the people who live to make God's name great ring out in eternity. You remember the saying, if you want to find your life, lose it. That's always been a code of ethics to truly live by. And that's why the name of Jesus is above all other names. Jesus. Jesus. Who gave up all the glories of heaven, squeezed his life into humanity. Before he went to the cross, said, Father, not my will, but yours be done. And because he lost his life for the eternal good of others, his name will endure by the praises of all of creation forever and ever and ever. Lord God, We have a choice every day. We can live to make our name great, which many times we all choose to do. We try to make our name great, and as a result, no one will remember our name. But we also have a choice to make your name great. Lord, would you give us the courage to die to ourself, to lose our life to find it, to make your name great. I think of our country and the turmoil it's in, and I think of politicians who live to make their name great and are remembered by no one. Lord, we have a choice, no matter what our vocation is, to make your name great. And when we choose that, I think of the psalm in Psalm 16:6, who says, "Indeed, my heritage is beautiful to me." So, Lord, let it be known that this day, on this piece of property in 2020, that we die to ourselves and we say, "You know what, Lord, I'm through making my name great. I want to make your name great." And where you're sitting before the Lord, will you submit to him? And ask him to make the application in your heart to say, "God, I want to live to make your name great. I die to self for your glory, for your honor." It's in Jesus' matchless holy name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. You know, before we sing, and I'm going to invite you to stand to sing here in just a second, but, you know, there's a picture in the scriptures where God rewards believers in eternity, and all of us who know Jesus as our Savior will be sitting in this massive stadium someday, and we'll be getting our rewards from Jesus, and they come in the form of crowns, and we don't exactly understand the picture. But we're recognized for what we've accomplished for Christ in eternity. But then the scriptures paint this beautiful picture that after everybody's got their crown, and I picture, you know, I get a chip of a crown or something, and I'm holding my chip of the crown, and some people have five crowns, and some people have two, three. And then all of a sudden, this miraculous thing takes place. As people realize that anything they've ever received is because the God of the universe granted it to them. And so in unison, it starts one by one in a trickle, and then everybody floods to the throne of Jesus, taking their crowns and throwing them at the feet of Jesus. And so then it doesn't matter what your crown was, or my little chip, or you were five. It was like, it was all about Jesus anyway. Let's include our time by taking whatever God has given us, whatever crowns we have, and I'm not talking about an offering, I'm just talking about your attitudes of your gifted, and to throw it at Jesus' feet as we pray through this song and as we worship him as we conclude our time. Let's all stand.
grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ the Father's Son in truth and in love. God bless.